I pray for all of us to choose the path that's right. Living our love every day of our life.
You are giving into what your friends want you to do, what your parents want you to do. I want this, I want that. Every human being is giving in to someone or to something. We are all slaves. No one is free. The Muslim man and the Muslim women, all of us are subjugated. All of us are slaves to Allah.
Do you know what Islam says? It says that life's the greatest test. It says that life's a borrowed space, returned upon rest. A complete way, a complete way.
We'll give women their right. We'll take another question.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. MashaAllah, Allah has given me a very good husband, three good children, two daughters and one son. My son asked me, Ma, what does it really mean to say that paradise lies at the feet of your mother?
Is that the question?
Yes, I have to give him an explanation. I was
Yeah, it's a very good question. Okay, I just wondered if you'd finished. Okay, that's yes. What does it really mean? That's a lovely question. And it's lovely because I think he wants to go to paradise. Alhamdulillah. And he realizes that, yes. And in fact, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, may his face be rubbed in the dust. This is the way the Arabs, meaning may he be humiliated. May his face be rubbed in the dust. May his face be rubbed in the dust. May his face be rubbed in the dust. Who is this, O Messenger of Allah? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, a man whose parents reach old age and he does not enter paradise by serving them. So one of them or both of them. So paradise lying at the feet of your mother means being kind to your mother, obeying your mother and not disobeying her. When she asks you for something, you do it for her. When she tells you to do something, you do it. When she needs your help, you help her. You are kind to her and you speak gently to her and you do not speak harshly to her. Indeed, you should not even say uff or huh. You should never speak to your parents like that. This is the respect that you should give them. So this is what it means really in reality to that paradise lies at the feet of your mother means serving her and being kind to her and being good to her. And at the very highest level of being kind and being good means to advise her about her Islam. If you see her doing something wrong, to encourage her to do the right thing. And at the highest level of, and in equal with that, also does not mean that when she tells you to do something that is haram, you go and do it. No. How is that helping your mother or serving your mother? That is only helping her to go to hell. Some people have this wrong idea. They say, oh, Allah said, obey my parents. That's why I'm working in a bank. That's why I'm marrying this bad woman who doesn't even pray. No. And there are some things I have to say also, that the mother does not have a right. It's not her right to say to her son, marry this woman that he does not want to marry. She doesn't have that right. Because you know your mother will die. Your mother does not have to live with that woman. Your mother does not have to, in the nighttime, go in that room alone with the woman. That's not your mother doing that, that's you. So this is not the right of the mother. Although the son should respect his mother and listen to her advice. It's very important actually, although this is not my topic, but it's very important for us to understand that the son has certain rights that are his rights. It doesn't mean the mother can order him to do everything. But in those other things, like helping her and serving her, he should do everything that he can. And this is what it means, and Allah knows best, by paradise lies at the feet of the mother. Wallahu alim.
Sisters, yes.
Assalamu alaikum. How did the women Sahabiyas learn about Islam? Was it through the speeches of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam only, or did they conduct classes? What is the actual method for women to acquire ilm? What is the ruling about women going out to seek knowledge? Does she always have to go out with her mahram?
Okay, I'm not sure I got all of that. Was the question about the importance of seeking knowledge, and when a woman goes out to seek knowledge, does she always need a mahram?
Yeah, and I even want to know about what about Sahabiyas. How did they learn? Like, how did they learn about Islam? Was it through the speeches of Prophet?
Yes.
Or did they conduct any classes? Thank you.
You know, the correct way to seek knowledge, the correct way to seek knowledge is by going and sitting and learning and studying from the people of knowledge. It is not only by attending seminars and 1 month, 2 month courses. Knowledge is something that takes time. And the best way to get that knowledge is from sitting with the people of knowledge. So generally we know that the Sahaba, the way they used to learn knowledge is they used to sit in the mosque and they used to learn the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they would study and write. Well, very few of them can write, but later generations they would write. But they would memorize, because in those days, in the time of the Prophet, they had a good memory. And so they would listen and they would memorize, and then they would act on that knowledge, and then they would teach it to others. Knowledge is not, as some people claim, by worshipping. You pray and pray and fast, and the knowledge sort of comes from somewhere, you get enlightened with knowledge. No. Knowledge is from studying, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. Umar ibn al-Khattab used to spend 1 day sitting in the masjid learning from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the next day he would work. And the day he was working, there was another Sahaba who was learning knowledge, and he will teach Umar the things that he missed on that day, and vice versa. This is how they learned. So this is the same for men and for women. This is the way to learn, and this is the way to seek knowledge. However, we have to say that although Aisha was truly a scholar in Islam, there is no doubt, Aisha is one of the greatest scholars Islam has ever seen. And this is why one of the wisdoms that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala married Aisha to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and Allah married Aisha to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam at such a young age. And we know after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam died, we see the benefit that Aisha brought. They used to say there was not one issue, not an issue they used to discuss, but they would go to Aisha and she would be able to tell them something about it. And more benefit was that although people used to learn from the Prophet the hadith, Aisha used to question the Prophet about those hadith. She used to ask, because many people were very shy before the Prophet. They wouldn't even look. In fact, some of the Sahaba did not know what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam looked like. He said, if you asked me to describe him, I couldn't, because they couldn't look in his face. That's how they respected Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But Aisha used to question the Prophet. Oh, Messenger of Allah, what does this mean? What does that mean? Explain this and explain that. So she would learn the meaning of things from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And she also was very beneficial in teaching. But in spite of this great status of Aisha in her knowledge, the Prophet did not mention her amongst those women who were reached that high level, like Fatima and Khadija and Asiya and Maryam. Because really the virtue of the woman is in being the wife and being the mother. This is the first and greatest virtue of the woman. She should have knowledge. It is good, and knowledge is an obligation upon everybody. And the women, it is an obligation of the women to have knowledge. But the emphasis is not so much on them. So there are two types of knowledge we have to discuss here. The first type of knowledge is what we call fardul ayn. Fardul ayn means a type of knowledge that every Muslim has to know it. Every Muslim has to know the difference between a tawheed and a shirk. Every Muslim has to know the difference between a sunnah and bid'ah. Every Muslim has to know their aqeedah. Every Muslim has to know how to pray. And then as the thing becomes an obligation, when you need to pay zakah, you must learn about zakah.
You have seen it, witnessed it, and applauded it. To witness again the most awaited event of the year in the entire Middle East, bigger and better, under the patronage of His Highness Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid Al Maktoum, Vice President and Prime Minister of UAE and ruler of Dubai. This April, be ready on 12th, 13th and 14th, 2012, Dubai. The city of festivals, the city of attractions and events, bringing back your dreams, will host Dubai International Peace Convention, aiming global unity through peace. World-renowned orators from various countries: Abdur Rahim Green, UK; Yusuf Estes, USA; Hussein Yee, Malaysia; Dr. Zakir Nayak, India; Muhammad Al-Sharif, Canada; Abdul Bari Yahya, USA; Saeed Rage, Somalia; Mayan Kutti Mata, India; Muhammad Salah, USA; Ahmed Hamid, India; world-renowned Qari Sheikh Mishari Rashid Al-Afasi, Kuwait; international Nasheed vocalist Abdullah Roon, UK. All will speak in one voice. Peace. Special guest of honor for Juma Khutbah and Salah, Sheikh Abdul Rahman Al-Sudais, Imam Masjid-e Al-Haram, Makkah, Saudi Arabia. Be a part of this incredible journey to be held Dubai World Trade Center. For more details, www.peaceconvention.com. Association with Al-Manar Center, under the patronage of Her Highness Sheikha Hind bin Maktoum bin Juma Al-Maktoum, wife of His Highness Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid Al-Maktoum. Don't miss it. Dubai International Peace Convention, aiming global unity through peace.
A man, a mission, a world-renowned orator on Islam and comparative religion, he dedicated more than five decades of his life for Dawah. Ahmad Didad.
We Muslims believe that Jesus was the Christ.
This book is an eternal book of guidance for you and for me, for the whole of mankind. It's a solution to the problems of mankind.
The miracle is when you expect a man to be dead and he's alive. That's a miracle.
Man with a Mission, every Sunday to Thursday, 6:30 p.m. Saudi Arabia and 7:30 p.m. UAE on Peace TV.
Every Muslim has to know the difference between a sunnah and bid'ah. Every Muslim has to know their aqeedah. Every Muslim has to know how to pray. And then as the thing becomes an obligation, when you need to pay zakah, you must learn about zakah. You must know how to fast Ramadan. When you have to make hajj, you have to learn, and it becomes fard al-ayn upon you to get that knowledge. And if you don't know it, you are sinful. This type of knowledge that's fard al-ayn, the woman should try, first of all, to get this knowledge from a place that is close by so that she does not have to travel without a mahram to get it. But if the knowledge that is fard al-ayn is not available in her town or her house or her village, then she is not only allowed, but she must go to get that knowledge from wherever she has to get it, because it is sinful not to have this knowledge. And so if she can't find a mahram to get this knowledge, she could travel even without a mahram to get that knowledge. Once she has reached that knowledge and she's got that knowledge, she should go back to her place of residence. And then the extra knowledge that's not farad al-ayn but farad al-kifaya, meaning some of us have to know it. But not every single person, not every person in this room has to know all the rules of inheritance. No. As long as some scholars amongst us know the rules of inheritance, that's sufficient. And there are different types of knowledge like that. Not only religious knowledge, but worldly knowledge, like being a doctor or engineering or computer science. Muslims have to know this knowledge, but not all of us have to know it. But some of us do have to know it. So this type of knowledge that is what we call farad al-kifaya, then that is not for the women. They don't have to go and seek that knowledge. They can if they want to, as long as they've got a mahram, but they do not have to therefore go without a mahram or travel without a mahram to get that extra type of knowledge that is what we call farad al-kifaya. So I hope that this is clear. The sisters could always get the knowledge, inshallah, through tapes, through video cassettes, through books. And if they are able to attend the lectures like the sisters have today, or to sit with the scholars when they are able to do that, this is very good, and they should be encouraged to do that, as Allah and His Messenger have encouraged all the believers to seek and get that knowledge. And Allah knows best. Wallahu a'lam.
My name is Arjun. And Dr. Green, all through your talk, you built up this argument of men being weak, men having passions and giving into them. At the same time, you also built up the argument that women are by nature more in control of their passions. But at the same time, Islam gives man the authority to enforce the law. And how can man who's weak, as per your argument, who gives into his passions, how can he uphold the law? And when you give man, irrespective of how many conditions come with it, you give man the authority to beat a woman, whatever the circumstance may be. It's a very powerful weapon in his hands and it's cruelly misused, as you well know. So what my point is, I think your argument is a little contradictory.
Yeah, with all the greatest respect, my argument is only contradictory if you're an argumentative person looking to find some faults in something. Because I don't think any reasonable person with modicum of intellect can honestly stand up there and say that what I said was a contradiction. It's not. It is very clear from what I said, and I think it's clear to everybody, that when I said man has a weakness in his passions, I was talking about sexual passion. It's totally obvious. This has got nothing to do with man's ability to rationalize and to rule and to judge and to work. They are totally separate things. So it is not a contradiction whatsoever. As for the woman's strength, I mean, she generally does not have that weakness in sexual passion. But she does have some other weaknesses in judgment due to her emotions that she needs in order to care for the children. They're not sexual emotions. They're the emotions that you need to relate to a child. That's what I also was talking about, which I think is absolutely clear. Okay? As for your statement about the authority of the man to beat the woman, it is not the authority I have given, it is the authority that Allah has given. If you think you know better than the creator of the heavens and the earth, then rather you than me will have to stand in front of him with that on the day of judgment. Since Allah is the one with so much knowledge that he created the chain of the DNA, he created the sun with all its complexity, the moon with all its complexity, our brain with all its complexity, the atoms of the universe that Allah brought together in such an amazing manner, yet you're telling me He doesn't know what rights to give to a man and what rights to give to a woman? I don't accept that. It's not what I am saying, this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. You make this claim, but then why do you not support also that the police have the right to use physical force to stop a criminal? Why? Why do they have that right? Is that not dangerous as well? Don't you find police abusing that right? Even in India here, don't you find the police beat up people unjustly? In America it happens, in Britain it happens, in Germany it happens, in France it happens. Is that an argument to say, therefore we should not have any police? It's not an argument. Yes, it can be abused, and it is abused. But there is a day of judgment, and there is law, and you have a judge. If a woman is brutally treated by her husband, she can go to court, and she can show her marks and where she has been abused. And her husband can be treated accordingly and punished accordingly under the law. But Islam holds at its foundation the family. The foundation of society is the family. If the family is corrupt and the family disintegrates, it is only a matter of time before society becomes corrupt and society disintegrates. I clearly laid down in my talk the conditions that Allah made for a man to use physical force against his wife. I clearly stipulated that this physical force must not leave a mark. Can we honestly say, with all of those conditions, that this is something unfair and this is something unjust, given man's responsibility over his family? I don't think so. Myself personally, I would never ever beat my wife. And when I say beat, I mean use that type of physical force on her. I would not do it. I would rather finish our relationship than do it. But there may be a certain situation. This is myself personally. I feel personally, if our relationship gets to that stage, then it's probably not worth going on. But there may be a time or a certain situation where you have to apply that. So the abuse of some people, and I am sure 99% of the brothers and sisters in this room have never experienced from their husband or their wife any type of beating or anything like that. Most of you, never. And most of the Muslims would never treat their wives like that, and vice versa. But this is there and has been given by Allah under certain stringent conditions. And I reiterate the fact that some people may abuse it does not mean that that power and that right should be taken away. Allah made it there for a reason and a wisdom. I will not question the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rather, all my experience in 16 years as being a Muslim, I have found out that every single thing I had a doubt about it in my mind about Islam, time proved it to be the truth. For 20 years, from the 1960s, 1970s, 1980s, up until the 1990s, for 30 years, the West has been pushing this propaganda that men and women are the same. There is no difference between men and women. Our differences are only due to indoctrination from our family. Women can be just as good mechanics as men, and men can be just as good at playing with dolls as women. And that's what they've been telling us. And people have been standing up in podiums and shouting and writing books about it. And what have we discovered after all of it? It was rubbish. And these people have been experimenting with millions of human beings. Millions of human beings experimenting with them according to their political correctness, which after all this time has proven to be scientifically rubbish. And what have we shown? That after all of this, Islam was all along saying the true thing. So I know Islam is from Allah. I know the Quran is from Allah. And I proved it yesterday. And I can prove it, if you give me more time, another day I will prove it even more convincingly, that any rational, sensible person can know that Islam is from Allah. Once we know the Quran is from God, then we as believers say, Sami'na wa ata'na. We hear and we obey. That's why we submit to Allah, because He knows what we don't know. Isn't that logical? Do you go to your doctor and the doctor says, I have to tell you, that if you don't take an operation within the next 3 days, you're gonna die. What do you say? No. First of all, I'm going to study this disease. What's it called? Hypochondros longa wrong this and that. You don't even know the name, but no, you're going to go and study the whole disease. You're going to study it. You're going to look at it. And then eventually, when you studied it fully, I'll think about having an operation. You know what? By the time you've opened your first medical book and you're dead already. So you trust your doctor. Your doctor says, do this. You do it. But Allah says, the creator of the universe says, do this. And you want to argue? You want to argue about what God says? What can we say to people like that? What can we say? Like I said, you'll see on the day of judgment when we stand in front of Allah who is right and who is wrong. Jazakallah khair.
Thank you.
Do you know what Islam is? It's a way of life for all. It is taught in the Quran for big and small. A way of life. Islam is a way of life, a complete way.